I think it's fair to say that one of the most successful aspects of Star Trek Discovery's Season 2 was Captain Pike. Despite the character having only appeared in a handful of Trek stories before Discovery, Trekkies everywhere, whether they despise or adore the latest iteration of the Trek franchise, all agree that the latest occupant of the captain's chair represents perhaps one of the best captains in the series' half-century legacy. He's so beloved that there has been an outpouring of support for a possible Captain Pike spin-off show, a series that would finally fulfill the promise of the original series' unaired pilot. Why has Captain Pike so captured the hearts of the fandom? Certainly much of the credit goes to Anson Mount's charismatic, nuanced performance.
We'll try to have a little fun along the way too, huh?
But I believe the rest of the credit lies with how Pike represents a modern example of leadership and masculinity. Today, there seems to be an endless discourse about what makes a positive leader, or how to showcase a version of masculinity that eschews toxicity. There also is an undercurrent of dissatisfaction with how those in power, regardless of which end of the political spectrum they hail from, tend to be working for themselves, rather than those they serve. We have also become much more critical of those who are self-centered, who only seek power, influence, and results at any costs. It's certainly not uncoincidental that Discovery's first season, which was much more directly influenced by today's political and social climate, featured a captain who pretty much represented this more authoritarian style.
Let me get one chance to get it right.
We'll do better next time, sir.
It will be hard to do worse.
So both within the show's world and in our own, Captain Pike is a breath of fresh air. He's personable.
Detmer, fly good.
Yet maintains an appropriate professional distance. He welcomes discourse and opinion, but knows when to take charge. He knows when to push back against authority, but doesn't let it become a habit like some other captains. Captain Pike isn't fueled by ego. He doesn't lead for glory or for career advancement. He doesn't believe that he deserves to sit in the captain's chair, but believes he has to earn that right each and every day. And he does so by trying to embody the ideals that that chair and Starfleet stands for. So let's dive into how Pike's lack of ego makes him a perfect model of leadership worth aspiring to. One of the first qualities that makes Pike a good leader is his ability to create an air of positivity and familiarity. Within the first few minutes of stepping on Discovery's bridge, he makes jokes and smiles at his crew.
Kidding.
Oh my god, I thought I broke a captain.
He learns each of their names and remembers them instantly.
Bridge crew, give me a roll call. Ord knows what's waiting for us down there. I want to know who I'm facing it with. Sound off. And skip your ranks, they don't matter. Clockwise from science.
He even begins to use nicknames, creating a more casual bridge atmosphere.
Find that beacon, please, Awoshikin.
Oh, well, walk on a tractor beam and bring him aboard.
By doing so, he creates a working environment that feels more open.
What should we do? How about we marry some folks, even if they're not that into each other,
huh? Oh, very good, sir.
This stands in direct contrast to Captain Lorca, who demanded unquestionable loyalty, and who was the only one who got to make final decisions on the bridge. As a result of this more open feel, Captain Pike enables there to be room for discourse, conversation, and dissent on his bridge.
Priests might be able to tell us about it.
Wouldn't that be a violation of General Order 1?
Though the Kelpians aren't warp-capable, they've seen warp-capable technology through the Bayou.
A good leader knows that they are not the best at everything. Instead, they listen to their advisors, who may know more about a subject at any time.
Burnham, as a xenoanthropologist, I think you're uniquely qualified to talk to a village priest.
But he is able to channel those conversations into something productive. He guides by giving his crew clear goals to accomplish, then listens to the options they offer. And by enabling these conversations, he allows his crew members to come up with ideas together that they never would have realized by themselves.
Recommendations.
We need to introduce randomness and chaos, sir.
Lieutenant Detmer, trust your training.
However, this has led to one of the biggest criticisms against Captain Pike, that he allows too much dissent to the point of having no backbone. I made a whole video diving into this specific topic, so I would encourage you to check it out. But I'll basically give a simple summation here. A good captain knows when things become unproductive, and when dissent becomes insubordination.
They mean to destroy my village. We have
Mr. Saru!
You will remove yourself from the bridge.
But Captain,
that's an order.
It's a tough line to toe, but I believe he's shown time and time again that he walks it with aplomb. This is perhaps one of the hardest aspects of being a leader, and showcases Pike's lack of ego. Many leaders believe that to be a good leader, they have to be the one who comes up with the idea. Yet Pike knows that just because an idea wasn't his doesn't mean that he has failed. In fact, just the opposite. It's because of him that the idea exists at all. In New Eden, he could have just held fast to his decision not to interfere with the colonists. Yet by listening to Burnham, he realizes that giving hope to a man who constantly seeks for an affirmation of his faith is the best course forward.
Do you, fly among the stars? Yeah.
Despite that, though, Captain Pike always knows when to take charge. Sometimes discourse and opinion can lose track or become counterproductive. Pike knows when to jump in, to pick a path or make a decision.
I'm trying, Lieutenant Detmer.
I'm trying my best, Captain.
Not good enough. This isn't a game.
On top of this, he also respects his crew's mental health and well-being. When Burnham states that she isn't ready to talk about her relationship with Georgiou, Pike doesn't push the situation.
And I ask that you bear with me until a more appropriate time.
Fun. Just don't make me chase after you for the information.
Thank you, sir.
Instead, he asks her to come to him when she is ready, instead of forcing her to open up like he could have as her captain. Later, he gives the crew time to say goodbye to Burnham when she decides to get stuck in the future.
Eyes up for Commander Burnham.
He also asks Saru to take care of himself during his Vahari.
You will need my help.
Saru, Commander Burnham can handle this. There's no reason to risk your health any further.
All of this goes to show a captain who expects the best from his crew, but never pushes them beyond their comfortability. Another aspect that shows Pike's lack of ego is his willingness to admit to mistakes. This is perhaps the aspect that most endeared me to Pike. When Pike comes aboard the Discovery, he knows that the crew has been working under the thumb of a much more militaristic, authoritarian captain.
You're en route to Vulcan to pick up a new captain. I was briefed on the classified details surrounding your last one. I know he betrayed this crew.
So in listening to the crew, he comes in with the assumption that they might be more willing to compromise their values, something that he doesn't believe should ever happen. So he makes it very clear where he stands.
I didn't sit out the war with my crew just to stand down now. Listen, I don't mind dissenting opinions, I really don't, but they have to come with solutions.
Yet Burnham corrects him to tell him that the crew wasn't trying to be defeatist, but was actually trying to solve the problem.
Yes, I have one. That's what I was trying to offer.
Now, this was obviously a mistake by Pike because he assumed how this crew was going to act. Many leaders would often double down on their mistake or take out their mistake on someone else, such as by yelling at Burnham.
Right there with you.
But instead, Pike realizes the mistake in the moment and moves on. The same thing happens with Ash Tyler. Pike believes the worst in Tyler, and almost acts on it. Yet when faced with the truth that Tyler is just as noble an officer as any other, Pike doesn't hold on to his prejudice, he releases it.
It's more than that, and I am grateful.
This also leads to another of Pike's great qualities. He deals with what he can see, rather than reputation. Burnham is, perhaps, one of the most disgraced officers in Starfleet. Despite redeeming herself last season, she still carries a lot of baggage. Yet Pike trusts her because she constantly shows him who she is. She's a confident, caring person who tries to do what's best at all times. And he sees that.
I'm very grateful, Commander, to have been here to watch you discover your heart.
Also, at the end of the season, we learn that Pike knew that Georgiou was from the Mirror Universe the entire time. He never treated her without respect or presuming that she was evil. He includes her in discussions. The only time we see him presume someone's intentions is with Leland, calling out the tactics and worldview of the morally gray Section 31, which goes against the values that he holds dear. Yet even here, he admits his prejudice and works to give Leland the benefit of the doubt.
I'll try to remember that my path is sometimes clearer than yours.
Yeah, I think what makes Pike one of the best captains is his vulnerability. Every captain before Pike has been distant, closing themselves off because they believe it makes them an effective leader, and they're not necessarily wrong.
Just how close do we get?
Let's just say there are some barriers
we never cross.
Kirk, Picard, Sisko, Janeway, Archer, and even Lorca all closed themselves off to their crew because they thought it was necessary. And certainly there is a need for a professional distance in a leader, and that's something that Pike respects. Yet Pike also allows himself to be vulnerable, both to those closest to him and to his crew.
I'm Captain Christopher Pike. Up there are my commendations, my diagnosis of childhood asthma. Ah, that big red F. That was my failing grade in astrophysics at the Academy.
He shares his faith and hope for humanity at all times.
I'm bound by my oath and conscience not to let it vanish forever.
He opens himself up to Vina as well.
I'm glad you're not alone.
He wears his faith on his sleeve around Burnham and opens himself up to new possibilities, even if it means that he may be wrong. Speaking of morals and values, Pike holds himself to an unwavering standard of morality. He calls out Starfleet's use of mines, recognizing that it goes against the core values of what it means to represent the best of humanity. And that's what Starfleet's supposed to be.
Giving up our values in the name of security is to lose the battle in advance.
He knows that we need to always hold ourselves accountable, no matter the situation, even in the face of incredible adversity.
I'm not going to abandon the things that make me who I am because of the future. It contains an ending I hadn't foreseen for myself.
This is the moment, more than any other, that shows the strength of Pike's character. Discovery makes Captain Pike's injury not an accident, but an intentional choice. He chooses to accept his fate because it's what needs to be done to save others. I've heard criticism that now that Pike knows that he is going to have that accident, it's bad writing that he doesn't try to avoid it. Certainly, Pike could quit Starfleet and avoid ending up disfigured and disabled. Yet, think about what causes him to end up in that chair. He ends up there because he's saving cadets' lives. I think it's the exact knowledge of what is to come that makes it impossible for him to avoid it. It would mean betraying not just in the present situation of defeating control, but because by sacrificing himself for the cadets, he saves others. And he doesn't want to betray what it means to be a Starfleet officer.
Giving up our values in the name of security is to lose the battle in advance.
His future becomes inescapable because to escape it would mean betraying everything that makes Pike himself.
For Starfleet, Captain. You believe in service, sacrifice, compassion, and love.
Pike follows his destiny because he makes his own destiny. He can't avoid his fate because he wouldn't have it any other way. He doesn't seek to be morally good because it advances his career or self-importance. We learn this because when it's pointed out to him that he emblemizes humanity's best, he's truly thankful and surprised. And it's the surprise that is the most important part.
We wanted the best of Starfleet to survive. And as this conversation makes clear, that was you. And all you represent.
Thank you.
He truthfully didn't realize that he had come to represent the very thing that he had always strived to be. It was just part of who he was. Discovery's Pike represents what Star Trek has always been about, showing us what we could be if we strove to actively pursue and cultivate the best parts of ourselves. The reason Captain Pike resonates today is because he is exactly what all of us wish we got to see more of out there in the real world. A leader without ego, who truly believes in our better nature and always fights for it. A man who stands not for himself, but for everyone else who can't stand where he is. He believes in service, sacrifice, compassion, and love. And as a result, comes to be an emblem of all of those ideals. He is humanity at our best.
It's good to be back in the chair.
Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you enjoy this type of Star Trek video essay or want other geek content, then give my channel a subscribe. I promise there's a ton of these great videos and I have a ton more coming out. And if you want to help make these videos better, consider giving to my Patreon page, just like these lovely folks did as well. And until next time, live long and prosper.